Ouais.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. For the next session today, let me invite Rishi Oberoi, Director, Games and Studio Digital, Disney UTV. He would take you through developing games for India, feature phones versus smartphones. Rishi, over to you, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm here to either wake you up or put you to sleep, since you guys are just joining me after lunch. So welcome to my session. We are here to talk about, basically, is there a market for gaming in India? Of course, there's a market for gaming in India, but where is that market for gaming in India? And how is the split between feature phones and smartphones? So let me introduce myself quickly. I'm Rishi Oberoi. I'm the production head of the production studio at Disney Interactive. We used to be India Games, and we were just acquired about 1.5 years ago by UTV, which was in turn acquired by Disney. And for the last 12 years, India Games and hence Disney Interactive has been working and helping create the mobile gaming market in India. So a lot of the talk is going to be about where we are today as far as the mobile gaming market in India is compared to where we were and where we are heading as far as the mobile gaming market in India is concerned. So let's start with what is the market? What is the market size? And let's start by saying what is the feature phone market size? Now, just to put a few definitions into this, the feature phones, what we'll define as feature phones is, phones that are fairly basic, that don't have too many smartphone capabilities. Let me put it the other way around. The smartphones are essentially all phones which come under the new operating systems that have been active for the last 3-4 years. iOS, Android, as well as the high-end Symbian and BlackBerry phones. So everything else which is lower than that, which have low footprint as far as memory is concerned, as far as processing powers is concerned, those are considered as feature phones. And India being really a flat pyramid market for almost everything, the same holds true even for mobile phones. So the maximum number of mobile phones in India is essentially feature phones. We have 600 million plus feature phones sold in India, with individuals. This is, of course, extrapolated from the fact that TRAI's number of subscribers is about 900 million. Now, even if you discount, 30% of that being dual usage or expired phones, etc., a lot of people have dual SIMs, etc. If you count the pure number of feature phones that are available in, that are with consumers today in the market, is about 600 million plus. Out of this, 60% of them are data enabled. So which means we're talking about 360 million of these phones have the ability to get onto the internet and browse the internet and possibly download apps and games, etc. But of the 60%, there are only about 40% of those that actually people who actually go ahead and do it. In the last 2 years or so, there's been a lot of work done from the telecom companies to essentially lead people into using more data by giving data plans being available for free and data costs going down, etc. And because of that, this number has jumped to 40% of active users. So we are saying that about 144 million feature phones in the market are people who are actually going and browsing the internet. And so this is your complete market size of people who could go ahead and buy a single game. But the feature phone sales is declining. We've seen this from the trend and from what we've been talking to OEMs and phone manufacturers who put out phones in the market on a month-on-month basis. So what we're saying is, where till about 8 months ago, the number of feature phones that they used to put out in the market and used to sell into the market was growing. From about 8 months back, it started plateauing. And they're saying within the next 18 to 24 months, it's going to start decreasing. It's not going to go away completely. So phone manufacturers like Samsung and Nokia and even your local OEMs like Micromax and Spice and Lava and all these phone companies, they're going to start shipping less and less feature phones out in the market. So what is the market size for smartphones then? Well, like I defined what smartphones were, you know, the high-end Symbian phones, the BlackBerry phones, as well as the Android, Windows, and iOS phones, that market today consists of about 60 million odd smartphones in India, out of which about 40 million are Android, and about 2 million plus is iOS. This is a rough estimation from market data as well as you know, industry knowledge, but you know, this is your whole universe of smartphone games. But this is increasing at a very very high rate. Just like I said, for feature phones, the same manufacturers who are taking out these feature phones, they are saying that there are going to be less and less feature phones in the months to come. They themselves are shifting over to smartphones, and they are going to be shipping out more and more smartphones in the months to come. And within a year's time, we'll see that there will be more number of smartphones shipped out into the market than feature phones, and the number of data-enabled smartphones and data-enabled feature phones, smartphone and feature phones will be on par. So I want to just go a little bit into understanding who the customer is. Who is this specimen, this Indian mobile game consumer, the person who's actually going, browsing these sites, finding out where to download these games from, and downloading it. This is essentially young India. This is the youth of India as it is. India today has the maximum population in the 15 to 25 age bracket. And they're the ones who are really, really active on their phones all the time. And they're the ones who have the ability and the time to go out and look for content and download the content and play games, browse, chat, etc., etc. And it's interesting to think about their mentality, who this audience is, and what do they like, their likes and dislikes, what is their core. We spoke to a few of them, and you know, just to understand, when we are making games, we want to know who our audience is. So when we did these discussions, we realized that majority of them, all over the country, have a duality. They have a dual perspective. They have dual nature. This means they have one life, which is a very very strong home life. They have a very strong family values. You know, they live with their parents. They do a lot of things with their parents. They eat together. They watch TV together. Their consumption of media and entertainment is from that perspective. And interestingly enough, they also consume the same shows and movies that their parents watch, even if they might be soap operas and Saas Bahu shows and all. This youth India will also watch them. But on the flip side, when they go outside of their house, they have a completely different social life. It's all about their friends. It's about their you know, their reputation with them. You know, it's about meeting people of the opposite sex and discovering themselves and growing up. You know. So with that in mind, we're trying to understand what is the type of content, what are the types of games will interest these type of players. And for a lot of them, if you consider that the 144 million is our market, 600 million phones in the market, and 60 million odd smartphones in the market, a lot of these people have never played a game on a console or a PC or online. So this is the first platform for gaming. This is the first time, like, majority of these people will be playing games for the first time on either a feature phone or a smartphone. And do they have the intention to pay? And the answer is yes. The first thing they do when they get their pocket money or they get their salaries from whatever jobs they're doing is they go and recharge their mobile phones. And when I'm talking about recharge by mobile phones, 95% of India is still a prepaid market. So that's how they get the money in their wallet, into their mobile wallet. And a lot of these people are now transitioning from feature phone to smartphone. And in this transition, something very interesting is happening. A lot of these people, because of the pure duality of nature that I talked about, they still use their old feature phone while also starting to use their smartphones. And a lot of these people have also played games on the feature phone. So they continue to play games on the feature phones. But they know what the experience of smartphone games also is. So even though they have the experience of smartphone games, they still play games on feature phones. And this was something which we found really, really interesting. So what do they consume? What are the type of games that they consume? So more or less, all throughout in the genres, it's about the same, whether it's feature phone or smartphones. We saw some of the data from App Annie that Rajesh presented at the keynote yesterday, and a lot of this is from the data that we see out of what we distribute and what we publish, as well as data from the stores. Essentially, this matches up with what App Annie says. In the feature phone side, racing is very strong, action is very strong, cricket is very strong. Interestingly enough, the reason for this is because, and this is not something I've mentioned, but the reason for this is because it's a very, very heavy male split. This could be because males just find it a lot more comfortable browsing for content and being a little bit more adventurous with websites and browsers on their feature phones to be able to kind of find the content. And because the maximum amount of the split is, like, say, 90% male as to 10% female, that's why all the content will be very male oriented as well. As opposed to that, casual plays a big role in the smartphone side of things. That's because discoverability is easier on smartphones. But generally, the types of games are about the same. There's racing, there's casual, there's action, there's games that are essentially simple to pick up, to play, to get into. Slightly heavier games where you require thinking and you require strategy, etc., are not as favored. So what type of games work in India? And this is across feature phones or smartphone. Well, what we've seen is international quality titles is preferred. You know, as long as the benchmark of that quality is really, really high, and it's a universal type game. And because racing is a top genre, an international quality game in the racing genre, regardless of whether it's from India, it's an Indian content, or it's international content, is viewed as universal content, and that really works well. Football is another interesting example. Even though the cricket is more accepted and is the more popular sport in India, football also works. Bollywood also works. Every time there's a major Bollywood release, the game on that Bollywood movie will be on the number one position for a certain period of time. But it's seasonal. It's not evergreen. In gaming, there's a term we like to call evergreen, which does not follow the pattern of, let's say, film releases, etc., where it does not just peak for 3 months and then disappears out of the limelight. What we want to create are games that are universal. You know, as developers, we want to create a game that we can build and it stays and kind of stands the test of time, but at least, 12 to 18 months. But unfortunately, because Bollywood is so tied into the movie releases, with Chennai Express and Krish 3 and now Dhoom 3 coming up, etc., these are all tied into movie releases. Therefore, the seasonality of it is very, very evident during the release of those movies. Cricket is also seasonal, and cricket also does very, very well. Cricket is seasonal too, when matches are happening, especially when the IPL is happening, when there's a tournament, when there's a World Cup, it does very, very, very well. But otherwise, it's slightly more evergreen because it's a sport and people in India love cricket. It's slightly more evergreen and it kind of lasts. And cricket is, but cricket is a little commoditized today. There have been so many companies in India over the last 12 years and so many games put out by so many companies in India that the user doesn't distinguish one game from the other. It's a little difficult, especially on the feature phone side, for users to distinguish one type of cricket game from the other. On the smartphone side, because the audio visuals are a lot better and the ability of doing a lot more is better, there's still some kind of balance where the better game will still win out. But at the moment, the user says, oh, a cricket game is a cricket game. What we're not seeing is, though, is original content. You know, and let me just justify this point. Original content that's coming up specifically for the market is very intermittent and not very successful so far. Original content that is universal, regardless of where in the world it's done well, that kind of also charts just like it charts anywhere else in the world. So if a game like Tetris has been doing really well, well, Tetris is a bad example because puzzle games is doesn't do that well. But you know, a game like Asphalt, which is a racing game, is doing really well everywhere else in the world as a racing game. It'll do really well in India as well. But having said that, original content which is made for India, either by India or by anyone else, is not really prevalent on the charts. There's no breakout hit, which is an original content made for that market. So that is the type of content that works on the charts. Where do these guys get these games from? On the feature phones, the majority of people consume these games which are already embedded. Of those 144 million people, even though they have the ability and they go ahead and browse the markets, it's about 50 to 70% of those people will end up consuming the game if it's already embedded in the game, embedded in the phone. That's where the operator, the manufacturers plays a big role. The phone manufacturer plays a big role, and all the games that they embed is the touch points that the user will have. The Indian consumer is not at that stage where they're going to want to go out and look for content. They'll be very happy to consume content that's already been given to them. And when they buy a new phone and they see a game that's already there, that's what they'll play. And that's also what they'll probably pay for. One step ahead of that is they'll go out and they'll browse a store that's already embedded onto these devices. For example, on a Nokia phone, you have the OV store, which is already embedded. On the Samsung phone feature phones, you have the Samsung Fun Club. If it's already embedded inside, the user will go, he will click on it, he'll browse that store, and he'll download the content. And then there are the other online WAP stores. This used to be the primary place to get content from, you know, before operators started creating their own stores. And before, you know, the internet on the mobile phone was opened up by the telecom operators. That this is now the tertiary place to get content from, but it still exists. On the smartphones, though, the first place they'll go to is, of course, the Google Play Store on the Android phone, or the App Store on the iOS devices, or you know, the marketplace on the Windows phones, etc., which is prominent from the operating system maker. And the secondary place will be the phone manufacturer's store. So a lot of Android phones, for example, have two or three or four stores, one which Google also already integrates, and the second or third which is integrated by the phone manufacturer themselves. For example, Samsung Apps. And of course, games out here also get embedded, fewer than on feature phones, but they do. And there are other online app stores as well, such as Amazon Apps other third-party app stores, where you have to. And this requires another discovery mechanism. This is for those people who really want to dig and find new content from other places. So what price points really work in these stores? Well, what we've seen on feature phones is that it averages around 40 rupees. You know, we have a range going all the way as low as 5 rupees, going all the way up to 100, 120 rupees. But the average, what we see, what works in these stores is about 40 rupees. Smartphones, though, is a completely different beast. Smartphones, the average price that we see actually that works is free. Because content is just so available, it's so freely available, that is what the maximum amount of, done, that's where the maximum number of downloads come from. Now, just to put that into perspective, the payment does not equate into consumption and vice versa. In feature phones, the prepaid market is still 95% of the telecom operator. The 95% of the market is still prepaid, and operator billing is the primary method of billing. There are no other methods of billing, and what happens with operator billing is it just becomes very seamless to the user. Sometimes, in fact, it becomes so seamless that the telecom regulatory authorities, the TRAI, they've gone ahead and put in 3 confirmations before you can actually buy it to protect the user. Because it used to happen that it was so easy for a user to just go ahead and click something and get charged that the regulatory authorities decided that they needed to do something and they needed to intervene. So operator billing is literally the easiest method and the most frictionless method to make a payment. On smartphones, though, most smartphones require a credit card for payment. Whether it's your out of that 40 million plus base or out of that 60 million plus base, most of those 60 million handsets requires credit card. Operator billing is not inherently integrated into those, especially into those, into the primary distribution mechanisms on those smartphones. And this is where the real problem is. This is why the primary method is free for distribution, is because only 1% of Indians actually have credit cards. This is from reports on credit cards in India, etc.